Visitors, good morning. I'm Jim Shelley. I'm not an ordained pastor. Want to put that out there? This gets paid here to be good. I'm here to remove nothing. Ask anyone. So, a couple weeks prior to doing the message, I started reading and reading and reading this. And the Lord speaks to us all the time. And he's got a lot to say in these couple chapters. I'm like, okay, I've got about 4 or 5 hour sermon coming. Is everybody get comfortable? But I'm just going to pick one point and say to you all the time. We want you back here tonight. Because tonight, this house is going to be playing some phenomenal music. We'll have light organ starting at 6, and then the service at 7. So we'll get to that. So I also used to do something called liturgy trivia. I'm going to do a quick biblical trivia. What's Jesus' first name? Jeff, you can't answer. Come on. Somebody know Jesus' first name? Emmanuel is one of the names that goes by. Very good, which means that God is with us. Yes. But his actual name, his real name was Yeshua, which comes from the Old Testament version, it's Joshua. His name is Joshua. How do we get Jesus? So, God done this right. So what happened was, so we went from Aramaic, Yeshua, and Hebrew, which Yeshua. Of course, in the New Testament, it was written originally in ancient Greek. So it changed a little bit. And then that got translated from Greek into Latin, which came out as Jesus, which we know. So if you go to like thoughts of mine, your Spanish will call it Jesus, right? So it's Jesus. So that's how we got it. That's how we got Jesus. So it's really not your name. It's close. So the other thing, by the way, when Epiphany comes and you see the wise men at the stable, they were there. Check Matthew. They came to a house. So, yeah. Here's your tribute for the day. Okay. We have mustard and bubbles. I still do Santa Claus. All right, so the two things that jumped out at me, there's so much in here. What really jumped out at me was two things. It's actually from Luke and from Samuel. Okay. I'm talking about what the Lord did with David. I took you from a pasture, from following the sheep and the shepherd. And I made you a prince over my people in Israel. And not just a prince, but he's still a famous king to this very day. Like 3,000 years later, everybody knows who David is. He was a shepherd boy. God did that. Impossible. You know? Impossible. God can do the impossible. And then we jumped to the gospel. I'm sure Mary's like, what is going on here? It's just 13-year-old girl. You're getting pregnant. Love it out. What did he say? For nothing's impossible with God. Right there, Luke. Bam. Nothing is impossible with God. If that's like slapping his face on a wake-up call, nothing is impossible with God. And what did she do? She said, here I am. Your servant. Do what you gotta do. And she knew those were not going to be easy. The unwed mother in that day. Not good. Not good. So nothing is impossible with God. He took a shepherd, turned him into a prince, took a teenage girl, and made him the mother of Jesus. Or Yeshua. There's a little quote from Ephesians that is used here quite a bit. But it kind of sums it all up. Now to him, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine. He's going to do more than we can even think about. According to his power. Oh, there's a caveat. His power, not ours. That is working in us. It's his power, not ours. And that's where we as people struggle because we want it our way, no way. Right? Which one of the fast food companies have your ways? Which one of the Burger King was? I stay away from those ones. I just stay away completely. But yeah, happy church. Man, we don't always get it our way, do we? All right. So, as we go into Christmas and we celebrate the birth of Yeshua, start thinking about what seems impossible in your life. So even in our darkest hour, when nothing seems possible, God is there. But we have to let him in. So how do we hear what the Lord is telling us? I know Jeff knows the answer to that one. How do we know what the Lord's telling us? I don't know. How do we find that out? Message is already there. Where's it written? Oh, what? Look at that.
It's the Bible.
Okay. Bingo. He talks to us all the time. He talks to us in these scriptures. Spoke to me. Speaks to me every time I read something. That's one of the neat things about having to be able to do these things. You know, like, you know, it's like being a teacher. You've got to be smarter than the students, right? One step ahead of them. Okay? Try teaching adult education. It's even more. I know. It's really rough. They beat you up. So, got to prepare. You read this, and the more I read, you go, wow, I didn't realize that. I've heard that before. I've heard this, like, you know, the last 60, well, I didn't listen for about the first 2 years. The last 60 years, we're going down. And there it is right there. Bam, bam, bam. God doesn't always speak with trumpets, loud voices, and banging cymbals, does he? How did he call Samuel? Does anybody know? I don't know. It was a whisper. It was a whisper. But barely hear it. Yeah. Barely hear it. The problem is we want to hear ourselves. I want to get my point of view out there. I want to tell you what I think. I want you to go my way. Have it my way. There I am, Birmingham. Does Chicken Lady then, by the way, have your way?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Just checking. So, but that's it. If we're so busy demanding what we want, we are not going to hear what God wants. We ain't going to hear it. It's not going to be heard. We've got to listen. Or like my mom used to say, put your mouth in the park and your mind in motion. She was a smart woman. She'll listen to a lot. Okay. Quiet meditation, prayer. That's what's going on. Reading the scriptures, that's what we're going to learn. If we're too busy speaking, we're going to drown it out. There's a cool book I found that completely off the subject of it's a non-liturgical book, trust me on that. It's called The Signal and the Noise. Why do so many predictions fail, but some don't? By this guy, Nate Silver. But he's talking about, you know, predictions, whether it be financial predictions, or weather predictions, or anything else. Part of the problem is that we can't separate the wheat from the chaff. We're hearing a lot of noise, and we're thinking that's a signal. Because of all the noise, we don't hear what the message is, and we miss it because of the noise. So we've got to be able to find a way to cut that signal out. That's where quiet prayer, reflection, and reading scripture comes in. Psalm 37 puts it this way. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways. When they carry out their wicked schemes, refrain from anger and turn from wrath. That's a tough one for me. I had to underline that. Star it, circle it. Why I had to print it out. That's why I rewrite it. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evil. Only to evil. My anger will just lead me down the wrong path. For those who are evil will be destroyed. But those whose hope in the Lord will inherit the land. Bam. I'd like to close this, if we could, together. I'm going to ask you to crack open your prayer books, your open home prayer. I clean the mold off. Carol, I clean the mold off. I'm serious. All right. Page 833. Prayer number 62. This is a prayer attributed to St. Francis, and this is just a really good prayer. Particularly with all the finger pointing and yelling going on in our secular world, which is why I stopped watching the news. It wasn't on my head to do that. Let's say this together. Everybody there? Prayer, it says 833, prayer number 62. 833, it's the prayer attributed to St. Francis. Lord, make us ministers of your peace.
Where there is hatred, let us sow love.
Where there is injury, pardon.
Where there is discord, union.
Where there is doubt, faith.
Where there is despair, hope.
Where there is darkness, light.
Where there is sadness, joy.
Grant peace.
hope, really good prayers.